Come on! Hurry up! Aw, man! Not now! Not now!
When Grand Theft Auto IV's first trailer was officially announced on March 1st, 2007, the GTA community, as it was back then, went insane with excitement. The new Roman numeral 4 logo appeared, along with a countdown to March 29th. March 29th then arrived, and at 5 p.m. that evening, their website went down. Too many people jumped onto it all at once, and I think back then most of us had connections that by today's standards would be seen as maybe not good, so it was at least another hour before most of us could see it. But when we did get to see it, it was nothing short of mind-blowing. The city, the vehicles, the Russian guy as everyone called him back then before we knew he was Serbian, and just the realistic look that everything took on now. But little did we know that by the summertime, the game was going to be delayed from October of 2007 to April of 2008, meaning that between the time of the first trailer's release and the time we actually got to play it, they had at least another year to work on the game. And there was a lot that they wound up changing, more than I think many people realize. So that's why I called upon all of you to help me look at this trailer and closely examine it, just so we can all try to pinpoint exactly what was changed. For starters, here's something that I don't think anyone actually noticed at first. The Fly US billboard appears to have no city name on it. These things usually say Visit Vice City or Visit Las Venturas or Los Santos, but I have a feeling that blanking it out was done on purpose to keep people from seeing a sign that says another city's name on it, and then assuming that those cities must be included in the game too. What's funny is that an uncovered one still says Visit Vice City in the distance. Now, what back in town on my Discord server did notice was that in the final game, the Fly US billboard isn't even present. There's a billboard for E-Cola instead. Another billboard in the distance was also changed to a Flisa billboard, a Hinterland ad also appeared on this sign. They also added more trees to this spot, which is why the Megamart sign is partially covered in the final game. Oh, and you want to know something that I actually never noticed before until Canuck690 and Captain Nachos on YouTube pointed it out to me? The train is moving in the wrong direction. In the final game, it always heads in the opposite direction from where it's coming in the first trailer. I don't know if maybe they reversed the direction that the trains move in, or if this was done solely for the trailer because maybe they figured that a shot of a train approaching from that side looked better than a train leaving. Next, we have this shot of Cisco Street in the Outlook neighborhood of Broker. Back in town, notice that besides the fact that this building in the distance doesn't have a billboard on it, they also notice that the shop on the corner doesn't have any signage. In the trailer, it looks like a vacant storefront, but in the final game, it's a beauty supply shop. And here's something that I just noticed now too. This streetlight has a street sign on it. It looks blank, but it's as if they actually planned on eventually adding the name of the street on it later. Kinda weird for it to be located here though, since those are usually at intersections and not just in the middle of the street. Maybe it was a separate streetlight model meant for corners and they accidentally placed it here. Some light posts with blank signs still exist in the game too, and it's a shame that they ended up leaving them blank in the end. Now here's a car that might not look like it's in the final game, but it actually is. Multiple people pointed out that this is the beta version of the Merit. In the finished game, the Merit is a Chevy Impala in the front and a BMW in the back. But in the beta version, it kinda looks like a 2004 Nissan Sentra. I am glad they changed the front end of the car, since I think it actually looks a little nicer in the final game, despite it being an odd blend of American and German motors. The mixture actually works. And not only that, but it now makes more sense for it to be the secondary cop car, since I don't think any police departments here in the US have ever used a BMW squad car. But back in the 2000s, next to using the standard Crown Victoria, they also would commonly use the Chevy Impala. The next scene shows something major that was cut. No, not the seagulls, even though as some of you pointed out on Twitter, they actually don't fly around like this anymore, do they? They were in episodes from Liberty City, but they would always just sit still and they were solely there as collectibles, which you had to shoot rather than collect. But the main major difference, as many of you pointed out, is the fact that there's a ferry docked at the ferry terminal. This is something that we never saw in the final game, and I don't even know if there's any remnants of ferries left in the game files, which tells me that maybe they were either cut not too long after this footage was recorded, or they just did a really good job with wiping out all content related to ferries. And you know, I just noticed something else. Where the hell is the other ferry terminal supposed to be? Maybe this is something we'll look at another time, since I've got a lot to say about this. The next few shots in the trailer don't have any major differences, except for maybe something like the sign for the Libertine Theater being blue in the final game instead of yellow. Until you get to this shot of Star Junction. The Pisswasser billboard has a monkey swinging on it, which is definitely not something that's present in the final game. It's not even a Pisswasser ad anymore. Now it's just a billboard for lager beer. Also, the ad for the Bank of Liberty has been replaced with an ad for CNT. Interestingly, this is the first time we ever got to see any street names in the game. It mentions the branch located at the corner of Columbus and Calcium, which of course is the one we end up performing a heist upon in Three Leaf Clover. Oh, and speaking of the Bank of Liberty, as pointed out by Paul Lennon at LenLFC on Twitter, that dome on the roof of the bank was originally transparent. I have no idea why this change would have been made, but I wish they would have kept it. Finally, we get this shot of a huge crowd of pedestrians and Nico, and besides the fact that some of the billboards have changed between then and the final version of the game, we also get a glimpse of female police officers, as pointed out by Mir at Mir21611 and Oh Mr. Zach on Twitter. I don't know why they would have been cut, but models of them were clearly made. Finn McGeckie was part of the team who worked on the NPCs, and he made this post on ArtStation showing, among other NPCs that made it into the final game, female cops. Mr. Zack asks if anyone has managed to find any audio files left over for the female cops, but honestly, I don't know if there were any. If there aren't any audio files left over for them, then maybe the voice lines for a lot of NPCs just hadn't been recorded yet by this time. If this footage was taken in early 2007, then this would be only a few months after the voice acting for the main story likely even began. Michael Hollick was hired in 2006, and the voice acting began in the later part of that year. And for the recording of character voice lines, I can imagine that random NPCs, including police, were not priority at the time. Mission dialogue and cutscene audio probably would have been the first thing they wanted to record. Therefore, female cops might have actually been cut before they began to record any NPC lines, but if anyone actually can manage to find these lines left over, do let us know. Next, we've got this shot of the warehouse from the mission Russian Revolution. Leo Lexell points out how there's a bunch of flying rats, aka pigeons, inside of it, when in the final game you never even see groups of pigeons all in one place, and there's definitely none to be found inside this warehouse either. Once the time lapse stops, we get this nice shot of the Algonquin Bridge, and I notice that the streetlights are a little different. It's something that most would probably find inconsequential, but I might as well mention it. They're a unique double lamp design compared to what's in the final game, where the lights on the bridge are the same ones that you'll find on the streets in the city. Also, they're located down the middle of the bridge along the pedestrian walkway. In the final game, you don't get any lights except for these smaller lamps closer to the broker side of the bridge. I wonder why they were changed. And then we get this shot of Nico with Michael Hollick reciting his Things Will Be Different speech in the background. Nico's character model definitely changed since then, and I can't put my finger on it, but something about this version of Nico just looks a little off. Gaye at Gaye Weird on Twitter points out how his facial structure does look different. His hair is definitely different, as several of you pointed out, and this hair model can still be found in the files too. And if I'm being honest, I agree with Plastic Cookie on YouTube that he kinda looks a little older too. Canonically, Nico was supposed to be 30 in 2008, but he could easily pass for someone in their late 30s or early 40s in this shot. Maybe he was originally meant to be a little older, or maybe he was always 30 and they realized that this model made him look a little too old. His outfit is also slightly different. Ricky Retriever on Discord pointed out how the texture for his leather jacket is different, the track sweatshirt underneath doesn't have blue stripe details that it has in the final game, and check out the zipper on him. Sunset Assassin on YouTube pointed out how it's kind of resemblant of something out of the 3D era. His model definitely looks like an earlier one compared to how he looks in the final game, and I'd say his look is definitely something they improved on as development went on. Also, notice how there's birds on top of the statue? Like I mentioned earlier, we don't really see animals like birds present in the final game outside of the 200 pigeons you have to shoot, and those just remain still. The Strange Man on Twitter pointed out how there's a bunch of barrels and this giant chain thing, I think it's an anchor chain, all next to the platypus as it's docked. In the final game, you don't get nearly this much stuff, just the barrels. And by the way, I just noticed the platypus was actually docked with ropes attached to the edges. Interesting detail, but something they removed for whatever reason. Also, this dock worker is holding a plank and standing still. It's not exciting at all, but it's something that they don't do in the final game, although the animation as well as the plank textures are still left in the files. Maybe they were cut because they're literally just standing around doing nothing besides holding a plank, when everybody else in Liberty City is doing something far more interesting, and when they have far more interesting animations, a guy just standing around awkwardly holding a plank looks more like someone who's just waiting until he could clock out but trying to look busy since his boss is nearby. One final thing, as pointed out by multiple people, Nico's walking animation in this final shot is a lot different from the way he walks in the final game. Several of you suggested that it might be CJ's walking animation. I'm not positive that it's that, but it does look a lot like something out of the 3D era. Slick on my Discord server pointed out that it's probably Nico's strafing animation. I'm just glad the animation was changed altogether, because that is what you call an iconic walk. Can you believe that GTA 4's trailer was actually revealed 13 years ago? And now, here we are 13 years later, the year 2020. Will GTA 6 get announced this year? Who knows? But I'm sure that some parts of the game will look at least a little different by the time it comes out, just like it did with GTA 4. Before we go, I want to give a big thanks to all of you who participated in Spot the Beta Differences. Have a wonderful day or night, or evening, morning, noon, whatever the hell it is where you are, and I'll see you next time.